You remember that time Conor McGregor ruptured his ACL mid-fight and still went on to defeat Max Holloway? Well, in this video, we're going to take a look back at some UFC history and explain exactly what happened in this wild event. Welcome back, everybody. I'm Dr. Brian Suter, and this is your number one source for learning about the unique medical side of the world of sports. I'm always amazed when athletes overcome crazy injuries like this, and so I want to look back at exactly what happened during the fight, McGregor's knee injury, and then talk about just why it's so wild that he not only finished the fight, but won. As always, if you enjoy learning about this unique side of sports, please consider subscribing to my channel and let's get started. There's really two kind of back-to-back sequences here where I think the injury occurred because McGregor mentioned that after he heard the pop, he switched into side control, and so we can kind of piece things together here. But into the second round, McGregor is here on top, and remember it's the left knee that we're worried about. So what we've got to pay attention to here is as McGregor's hips start to turn right there and sort of pivot, we can see that knee kind of coming inward. Now this position, typically when this knee collapses inward, basically causes some increased stress on the ACL. We call this a dynamic knee valgus, and it's a combination of how you can see his trunk almost leans a little bit more over to this side, that leg and the femur kind of fall inward, and then there's a little bit of tibial rotation. Now this position is also gonna be more vulnerable to the MCL and the meniscus, which are two of the other injuries that McGregor had, so it's possible that this specific little movement could have caused them. Now, if we advance a little bit here in the clip, there's one other time where I think this could have occurred. A few seconds later here, again, McGregor's trying to get out of this position, and we can see again another substantial twist and torque that's applied onto that left leg. Holloway is basically rotating his hips to push down into the ground, which is gonna cause McGregor's lower leg to kind of fall inward and again put this kind of twisting moment onto McGregor's knee right there as he kind of tries to break through it. So again, what we're seeing there is we're seeing that dynamic knee valgus where the knee comes inward, and we even see a little bit of internal rotation there with the femur. Kind of right here, that foot is pointed inward, meaning there's some internal rotation. It's hard to say exactly between these specific two sequences which one really kind of was the final blow, but both of them would fit with the time when McGregor tore the ACL. Right after this, then of course we can see here's where he switches into side control. So that tells me that it was one of those two times where he blew out the knee. Now, Dana White told reporters afterwards that McGregor suffered an MCL strain, posterior horn meniscus tear, and then of course the ACL tear. If we take a look at our anatomy here, this is the inside of the leg and this is gonna be the outside. So that MCL is gonna sit here on the inside of the knee, running from the femur down to the tibia. LCL, of course, is gonna sit here on the outside, and then deep inside there, we've got our ACL. And then if we look all the way around on the back, we've got the PCL. Our two menisci then, of course, sit inside the compartment of the knee. And so this guy here is going to be the medial meniscus, which McGregor injured. The posterior horn of the meniscus is going to be this portion that sits right here in the back side of the meniscus. This up here is going to be the anterior horn. And then the roots of the meniscus are going to be the areas kind of where that meniscus inserts into the bone. So the posterior horn is going to be this area with somewhere kind of like that where McGregor could have had a torn. So McGregor's meniscus injury was somewhere here in this back portion of the medial meniscus. Now, MCL injuries and meniscus injuries typically go hand in hand because the medial meniscus is actually attached to the deep fibers of the MCL. If we zoom in here, of course, this picture shows it a little bit, but these deep fibers of the MCL actually anchor onto the meniscus. So when the MCL pulls, it's gonna pull on the meniscus, which is gonna sort of reposition it incorrectly, and that's gonna make your meniscus more susceptible to getting torn. Tolerating pain in UFC is one thing. Guys can sort of get used to it, they can build up a pain tolerance, but when you tear your ACL, it's not just pain that you're experiencing, it's much more so a loss of function because of the instability that you're gonna have in your knee when you're trying to move around in the octagon. I've got the ACL shown here, and the femur is sort of hidden, but I want you to understand what exactly the ACL is preventing in terms of motion. So the ACL is running from the anterior portion or the front of the tibia up to the back portion of the femur. So the main thing it's doing is it's providing stability to prevent the tibia from sort of sliding forward relative to the femur. We don't want the tibia to go out this way. And so the ACL is gonna keep it in there in place to prevent that anterior tibial movement. But it also has some rotational component because if we spin this around, you can see how there's a little bit of an angle that the ACL runs. And so not only is it gonna be unstable kind of forward and back, but it's also rotationally gonna be unstable. And it's not just the stability that McGregor has to overcome. It's also the rapid swelling or effusion that's gonna take place in his knee joint because the ACL has blood supply running to it. And when you tear the ACL, you rupture those blood vessels and you get a big effusion that causes a lot of stiffness and swelling That's also going to limit your mobility. Now, the muscles in the hamstring can help a little bit when somebody is ACL deficient because the way that they run through the body biomechanically is trying to do essentially the same kind of thing that the ACL is doing. This is one of our hamstring muscles that I have, and of course it runs down the backside of the thigh and attaches down on the tibia. So if you think of these muscles like a rope, when that hamstring muscle pulls and fires, it's going to swing the leg up into knee flexion, but it's also going to cause the tibia to be pulled a little bit backwards. If you're pulling the tibia backwards, of course that keeps it from moving forward, so it's essentially trying to help kind of mimic the role of the ACL. That's part of why it's really important to train your hamstrings properly when you have an ACL injury, because that ACL is going to be supported by a good, healthy hamstring function. Now, this quickly in the ring, it's going to be really hard for that to kick in, but McGregor talked about how in his future ACL sprain that he had later on, this kind of helped him develop some of that stability in his knee because he remembered how to train these muscles. And this is really the fundamental concept of why you work on your muscles when you have an ACL injury. I know someone's going to say that there's much crazier injuries guys have suffered in the octagon and have overcome, but functionally, I think this is one of the hardest to overcome. It's not going to be the most painful, but guys can sort of get used to pain tolerance, but it's really hard to get through this instability when you have such a major ligament injured in your knee. I can't wait to watch the McGregor fight this weekend. I know you guys are going to be watching it as well. I hope this was interesting to take a look back at one of these historical UFC moments. Let me know as always any questions or comments down below. And until next time, we'll see you later. Bye.